And now welcome to the United States Croquet Association AC National Championships in March of 2024. They're held at the recently renovated Sarasota County Croquet Club in Venice, Florida. The new courts are these three at the bottom of the screen. They have new shelters as well. It is a fabulous facility. Club president is Jim Colling, and tournament manager for this event is Nancy Hart. The aerial views are courtesy of Brian Hovis's drone, and Brian is the videographer for this event as well. Tournament director is Jeff Sue, with able assistance from his wife Eileen. And as always, we want to thank our sponsors, Chris Barley, the United States Croquet Association, under the guidance of President Damon Bidenkope, your source for all things croquet in all of its many versions, AC, American Rules, Golf Croquet, and Nine Wicket. And for all your equipment needs, be you beginner, world champion, or anybody in between, Don Oakley's Croquet Store. And now, game two of a quarterfinal match between doubles partners. Jeff Sue in the white hat and Vay Low were second to Tom Balding and Steve Scalpone in the doubles earlier this week. You can check out the doubles playlist, the first game where their names appear, for their biographical information. Jeff is your tournament director. He's, I think, has 16 national champions, has been on multiple Teams USA for Solomon, McRobb, etc. And he's a mainstay of development at all levels in American croquet. And he's now on the management committee of the World Croquet Federation. Vay Low is from South Africa. He was an elite compatriot of Reg Bamford till he left in 2000 to come to this country. He now lives in Gainesville. Stopped playing, I think, in 2006, and this is his first tournament after that hiatus. I believe he did represent Team USA in one Mick Robertson Shield test, an opportunity he would not have had living in South Africa. So, no opportunity for a third turn break, so he's basically sitting in diagonal spread without the peg ball. I'm sure you've noticed the lack of ambient sound. Brian's microphone malfunctioned on this day. He got it fixed the next day, but enjoy the lack of highway noise. He's setting up the rush on white after he makes three to pick up green from near the east boundary. I would have been inclined to take off from the other side, do a thick takeoff, and kick green over toward the center of the court. But he's being extremely patient. He doesn't want to complicate any shot if he doesn't have to, and he knows he can always go back and pick up green. Far be it from me to tell you what Jeff Su is thinking, but what I would be thinking here is, should I roll green to five while I go to white so that I can drop off green as a two-bag pioneer early? I think the fact that pink is not a great hoop six pioneer may be influencing this decision. he doesn't really have room to send green to two back and get a good rush on pink. So he's going to solve the problem of not having green as a three-back pioneer by keeping it in pivot position. That was just weird. Ooh, maybe finally somebody's going to get a good rush out of three bag. He's the first one that's played this like it was important. That sequence of shots is what Wiley wants you to practice at three back. Usually I would have cut this out where he goes back and gets Brown, but I am amazed at how rigorous these guys at this level are about always going to the ball that went out first so that the marking in is absolutely accurate. Then they go back and get the striker ball. So in turn five, Jeff goes to four back. Nice diagonal spread. Diagonal is not a forcing leave, so I have no idea how these guys decide which ball they're going to pick up if they're both for hoop one. Jeff has 313 triples and singles and 20 TPOs, so I think Vey assumes that if he misses, Jeff's going to triple him, so he's taking the shorter shot. Jeff or Stuart are welcome to correct me in the comments, but I think he's going to rotate pink first so that he can rush brown to hoop one. When you make one off the pili, I think it makes it easier to get the triple going because then you can send the pili back to this side of the court, if not to hoop three. When the pili is the hoop two pioneer, it usually ends up being a delayed triple. Wiley makes the comment in discussing the four-back peel that I think he said as long as you have a good hoop four pioneer, the escape ball for after the four-back peel can be anywhere. I think he'd still like to have pink a lot closer to four-back than it is. Let's see how he does that. I'm thinking he wanted that rush on Brown to go another 2 or 3 yards farther. Ooh, same thing for that one. Pink should have been much closer to the hoop. I asked for comments on the continuous scoreboard in the last video. I got one response. That viewer was in favor. It's a bunch of work, so I'm going to do it when he starts peeling so you can keep track of where everybody is. When I first started doing this, I would hit a big pass roll here, trying to put the Pele near penult while I went to five. But the Pele always ended up out there in left field, halfway to the west boundary. The good players all do what Jeff did. They just take off from that Pele, knowing that it's no problem to go back and get it after they make five. And you know, Jeff, Sue's not going to rush Brown into the peg, so give us a like, subscribe, hit the notification bell. Thanks, as always, to our sponsors, Chris Varley and the U.S. Croquet Association, your source for everything croquet in the USA. And a special thanks to Don Oakley and the Croquet Store, supplying the equipment needs of every level of expertise in all four disciplines of this wonderful game of ours. So it's Jeff Sue over Velo, 2-0. Jeff moves on to the semifinal against Zach Watson. Stay tuned, there's a lot more high-level croquet coming up.